Good evening, everyone. I'm Morgan Cooper, Associate Vice President, Academic for Faculty Affairs, and it's my pleasure to welcome you all this evening, the Royal Society of Canada's new Fellow of Public Lecture. In particular, I would like to acknowledge other Royal Society Fellows who are here this evening. Thank you for supporting Memorial's newest Fellows. And members of community groups that Peter has collaborated with over the years, it's great to have you all here. In October 2012, Dr. Peter Pope, a professor in the Faculty of Arts Department of Archaeology, was named a new fellow in the RSC's Division of Humanities, and I am pleased to celebrate the accomplishments of Dr. Pope and all local Royal Society of Canada fellows and share in their success. The Royal Society of Canada is the senior national body of distinguished Canadian scholars, artists, and scientists, and the oldest association of scientists and scholars in Canada. This lecture will be the second edition of the newly launched RSC Atlantic Public Lecture Program. RSC Atlantic was formed in 2008 with a mandate to engage more directly and dynamically with RSC fellows, new scholars, institutional members, existing and new stakeholders, community institutions, and private sector supporters in Atlantic Canada. Reaching out to university partners is an integral way of how we work here at Memorial. We have a long history of public engagement, so the public lecture program is a perfect fit. We strive to have national and global impact while fulfilling our special obligation to the people of this province. And it is the research of people like Dr. Pope that is helping us achieve our vision to be one of the most distinguished public universities in Canada. There are amazing things happening at our institution with our researchers tackling big questions through an expanding and diverse research program. Tonight, we have the pleasure of learning a little more about work being conducted by one of these outstanding researchers. I now call upon Lynn Phillips, Dean of Faculty of Arts, to introduce Dr. Pope.
Thank you, Morgan. Welcome on this balmy St. John's evening. It's about time we had one of those. Well, we are justly very proud of Dr. Peter Pope in the Faculty of Arts. He's truly an interdisciplinary scholar, as comfortable, I think, as much in history as he is in archaeology. And he has, without doubt, retrieved Newfoundland's pivotal historical role in the expansion of the North Atlantic world. In his work, Dr. Pope has always been very generous in his methods, seeking evidence in all sorts of places, legal archives and other archives, museums, and in the remains he himself has excavated and identified at early modern archaeological sites. His vision is both broad and fiercely specific. Broad in that his work showcases the vernacular links between the old and new worlds and does not lose sight of a global context in which interpretation must be situated during this time period. And fiercely specific in that his eyes never stray from Newfoundland, from what we like to call the local. It is here that Dr. Pope finds the real story, where examining both French settlements and English settlements, he finds lives that have been forgotten and hidden from dominant versions of history. Dr. Pope is best known for two prize-winning monographs, The Many Landfalls of John Cabot and Fish into Wine, the Newfoundland Plantation in the 17th Century. The latter was considered by the Journal of Interdisciplinary History, quote, a brilliant and meticulous historical reconstruction of the 17th century fishery, unquote. And it is a book that has been instrumental in sparking interest in early modern Newfoundland among historians as well as other disciplines in Canada, the United States, and Europe. Dr. Pope has also made countless other contributions to understanding the early Atlantic world, including authoring review essays, reports, journal articles, participating in radio shows, you name it. Most recently, he co-edited the volume Exploring Atlantic Transitions, a book which explores population mobility and immobilities during the European expansion to the Americas. A university research professor, Dr. Pope received a major CURA grant, otherwise known as the Community University Research Alliance grant from SHRC in the year 2000. The Newfoundland Archaeological Heritage Outreach Program supported a range of community research projects during this time, including significant research on the historical archaeology of 16th century settlements at Cupids, Fairyland, and Placentia. Dr. Pope's close ties with the French Shore Working Group of the program opened a new area of research for him on the traditional migratory fishery of northern Newfoundland, the archaeology of the Petite Nord, about which he will be speaking to you this evening. Dr. Pope has served on editorial boards and on various committees, but perhaps his true legacy is the one to be found in his students. Students from all over have come to study with Peter Pope, and he has generously trained a long list of graduate students and undergraduate honorary honor students in the field, as we like to say, and supervised their theses, always, always urging them to do their best. Dr. Pope's work has shifted historical opinion to recognize the central place of Newfoundland and the cod fishery in understanding early modern Atlantic regions. He has done this by raising thought-provoking questions about the invention of tradition, early modern vernacular capitalism, and maritime cultural landscapes, all issues that resonate well beyond our borders. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my great pleasure to give you Royal Society of Canada Fellow Dr. Peter Pope.
Thank you. Thank you, Lynn. I'm audible. Can you hear me at the back there? Okay. First, I want to thank the Royal Society, Atlantic Section particularly, for organizing these talks. And also Ellen Steinhauer from the Vice President's Office for organizing the event tonight. And thank you to the audience for coming and listening to what I have to say. It's kind of a trial. I should write a book about this stuff. It hasn't happened yet. This is kind of a trial run. Okay, I'm going to try out some ideas. I have to find my little machine here. The transatlantic fishery, the shore-based salt cod fishery, is one of the extinct large reptiles of economic history. Almost forgotten now, it was in its day an enormous economic organism. France alone, we're mostly talking about France tonight, sent about 10,000 men every year to catch 50 million cod, to dry and salt them, and ship them to markets in southern Europe. Back in Normandy, Brittany, and the Basque Country, whole regional economies depended on these voyages. The Bretons were fishing in the New World as early as 1508. The Normans also exploited the dry salt fishery in the early 16th century, but after the development of an offshore cod fishery on the Grand Banks, which happened around 1550, most Norman ports turned their energies in this direction. The Basques competed effectively around Placentia, in the Strait of Belle Isle, and in the Gulf of St. Lawrence. Now, quick review of the political history here. In 1713, the Treaty of Utrecht confined Basque, Breton, and Norman fishers to a French shore on Newfoundland's northern coast, an arrangement that was modified in 1783 to include all of the island's west coast. These treaties made little difference to the Breton crews who had been coming annually for centuries to the Atlantic coast of Newfoundland's Great Northern Peninsula, the fishing zone that they called the Petit Nord. The Petit Nord lay within both the French shore of 1713 and 1783, but Breton crews had caught and dried fish here for two centuries before the diplomatic definition of this fishery. Breton crews continued to exploit this coast until France abandoned the right to a shore fishery in Newfoundland under the Entente Cordiale with Great Britain of 1904. So one of the first parts of North America exploited from Europe was also one of the last. The interdisciplinary research project, An Archaeology of the Petit Nord, has approached this region as a maritime cultural landscape, I'll come back to that concept, which evolved over four centuries. Tonight, I'll give you a look at the excavation of a fishing station in Cape Rouge Harbor, known to the Breton crews as Champéa, in the context of our archaeological survey of historic French fishing rooms scattered along the Petit Nord, from Le Cie in the northeast coast to Carpoon in the Labrador Strait. Migratory crews from France put the fishing stations of the Petit Nord to the same use for about 400 years, so it's reasonable to expect that we'll find a clear archaeological signature of their activity in the region. It seemed like a logical idea. Some important sites are obscured by the subsequent permanent settlements of Anglo-Irish settlers, or Liviers, as they called themselves. And Taylor's Point in Conch here is a good example. Some sites were never intensively used as anything but seasonal fishing rooms and have therefore largely escaped cultural disturbance. For example, the Breton fishing station of Champéa, now the archaeological site d'Eau de Cheval in Cape Rouge or Crouse Harbor. Cape Rouge, Crouse Harbor, that's sort of two names for the same place there. In this sense, the fishing stations of Newfoundland's Petit Nord are ideal places to record the maritime cultural landscape of the migratory fishery. Most are visible in archaeological survey as well-defined open coastal areas within the boreal forest. It's not rocket science finding them. Several fishing rooms in Cape Rouge and other harbors were also commemorated by prominent oak crosses. This one erected on the terrace behind Champéa by the French Navy in 1934 to replace an earlier cross. Fishing rooms remain visible on this coast in physical changes to the cultural landscape brought by migratory Breton fishermen through four centuries before they surrendered their fishing grounds to Anglo-Irish Liviers in 1904. The small settlements of the region actually grew within the matrix of the French migratory fishery. After 1713, the French themselves were forbidden from overwintering, so there was no settlement in that early French fishery. They were only there in the summers. That means that the original settler of virtually every one of these small communities was an overwintering caretaker. These guardians had to be British subjects, because you had to be a British subject to be resident on the coast, but they were often of Irish origin. Patrick Carney, who settled the fishing room Genil in Croke Harbor sometime before 1868, is an excellent example of a guardian who founded a family of Liviers who are still there. Genil is now Carney's Cove. How do we know that? We simply have to read the landscape. It's right there. The Anglo-Irish Liviers are still there. And in the last few years, they've embraced the history of the transatlantic migratory fishery as a major element in their own cultural life. Visitors to the region will learn much, I think, from thoughtful interpretations at the French Shore Interpretation Center in Conch and at the Grand Chêne exhibit at Griquet Saint-Lunaire. If you're up on the northeast coast and you're traveling, you should don't miss either of those places. They're very good exhibitions. Our archaeological study of the Petit Nord is inevitably interdisciplinary as well as multi-scalar, involving the interpretation of oral, documentary, and cartographic resources in addition to archaeological survey. At the narrowest scale, our research program has focused on archaeological investigation of the Champéa fishing room at Crouse. The broad canvas of the whole Petit Nord between La Cie and Fleur-de-Lis in the southeast to Griquet and De Gratte in the Strait of Belle Isle blends historical cartography, early fishing censuses, and narrative accounts supplemented by field survey, which enabled us to get a photographic record of sites and to collect artifacts for dating purposes. We've now recorded over 60 fishing rooms once used by migratory French crews, abandoned fishing rooms, almost all of them. One major aim of our project, an archaeology of the Petit Nord, has been to develop an accessible synthesis history of European exploitation of the region over the long durée. And we framed this broad goal as a question about the evolution of a maritime cultural landscape. We put some of our survey results online, and you can visit the Petit Nord. If you want to see more of these sites, just you can go to that website. If you can't remember that long URL, just Google Niche Petit Nord, because Niche is the organization that sponsors the site. So let me talk a little bit about our approach to this work theoretically, because landscape is a sort of a slippery word. It's a portmanteau concept, I think philosophers would say. It carries a lot of baggage. Besides its diffuse aesthetic and ecological connotations, landscape also raises questions, at least for archaeologists, about the social construction of memory, which is really an important part of the task at hand. The English term landscape seems to have evolved in parallel with the Dutch concept landschap. These terms evoke something that I think is elided in the French paysage, insofar as they reflect the enduring dialectic between the physical world and human society. French does have the wonderful concept pays, meaning a cultural region, and I think that's kind of how they raise similar questions. We have found another related concept useful in surveying several hundred kilometers of Newfoundland's rugged coast. We use the term landmark for a place where human interactions and activities occur, for example, where people access a natural resource. Now, prehistorians have called these sorts of places persistent places, but we chose to adopt terminology proposed by the American archaeologist Maria Zedeno. Landmarks, in her way of thinking, are pages in the history of land use. Well, a landscape is a whole chapter, incorporating the social webs that link people and landmarks over time. So landscapes, by Zedeno's account, have life histories extending for centuries, certainly true of the Petit Nord, and those landscapes contain landmarks of various ages and complexity. The refinement of these concepts of landmark, landscape, and the social histories that link them was an important analytic step for us because such concepts offer a way to approach the thought-provoking but somewhat vague idea of maritime cultural landscape, which was proposed by the Swedish marine archaeologist Christer Westerdahl to emphasize the interpenetration and interdependence of land and sea and coastal zones. But he doesn't take it much farther than that. The most obvious kind of landmark in the early modern transatlantic fishery was the fishing room. These were the shore stations needed for splitting, salting, and drying cod caught in daily voyages by boat crews working for a particular fishing master. Although fishing rooms were certainly landmarks, or persistent places for a prehistorian, within the wider context of a fishing harbor, or even of the whole Petit Nord, their complex structure suggests to me that they were, in their own way, landscapes as well. Each fishing room was an arrangement of features, stages for landing fish, cobble beaches, wooden flakes for drying, cook rooms, bread ovens, crosses and calvaries and so on. And each of these features was a landmark within the miniature landscape of the fishing room. So what's come to me, and I'm publishing something about this now, I would suggest that the relation of landscape and landmark is recursive. Landscapes of different scales nest, like matryoshka dolls, one within another, so that a landscape at one level is a landmark taking a broader view. Thus, we might see a fishing room like Champéa, harbors like Krauss, or even whole regions like the Petit Nord as landmarks if you took a wide enough maritime cultural landscape. So tonight's presentation essentially explores this recursive aspect of the relationship between landmarks and landscapes, that something can, you can see it in one way as a landmark within a larger context, but you can also see it as a landscape involving similar landmarks. I'm going to start at the broad scale, the whole transatlantic migratory fishery. Now, one of the things, if you get into the documentation on this period, you realize pretty fast that it's actually relatively rare for commercial documents of the 16th, 17th, or 18th centuries to mention specific fishing harbors, in whether in Newfoundland or anywhere. Just for example, after 1680, captains returning to St. Malo had to file reports on their voyages. But these accounts, it's frustrating. You'll find an account, it'll have something interesting in it, but it'll just say, we went to the Petit Nord. It doesn't say we went to Krause, or we fished at Champéa, or something like that. Or if not the Petit Nord, perhaps the Chapeau Rouge on the south coast. So that's usually about as close as you get, or Gaspé, or wherever they went. From the transatlantic point of view, a whole regional production zone, a whole region to us, was seen as a landmark. One of several important migratory fisheries on the coast of Atlantic Canada, and there you have most of them there. In Newfoundland, these included the English shore on the Avalon Peninsula, the Old French shore around Plaisance and the Chapeau Rouge, as well as the Basque coast facing the Gulf of St. Lawrence. Elsewhere, French transatlantic crews fished the inshore waters of Cape Breton, the Gaspé Peninsula, the St. Lawrence North Shore, and in the early days, southern Labrador, Acadia, and the Gulf of Maine. These were North American landmarks within a broad transatlantic landscape. And if you think at this scale, you have to include the provisioning ports in Portugal, Galicia in one period, the Basque Country, Western France, particularly Normandy and Brittany, England's West Country counties of Devon and Dorset, as well as Waterford and Wexford in Southeast Ireland. All these regions involved in the transatlantic migratory fishery, seen together at this broad scale, it remains more a landscape than a gigantic landmark. Could you see that whole zone as a gigantic landmark? Well, you could if we viewed all these ports and fisheries together retrospectively as one key circumatlantic zone in the emergence of the modern economy, or indeed as a concrete example of center-periphery relations. So that's the big scale. Let's zoom into the Petit Nord. The surviving documentation of the 17th and 18th century fishery indicates that Breton fishermen saw the Petit Nord as a distinct and coherent maritime landscape. Their ethnicity separated them from the Basque crews who exploited Port Aoix and the other harbors on Newfoundland's west coast, as somebody noted on this map about 1700. And the Basque had fished earlier on the south coast, too. In the 17th century, Basques and Bretons had abandoned the east coast of the Avalon Peninsula to the English. After 1713, they technically had the right to fish the northeast coast, north of Bonavista, in Notre Dame Bay, and Bonavista and Notre Dame Bays, but they didn't, mostly, apart from a brief reassertion of their privileges following the Treaty of Paris in 1763. I don't mean they weren't there at all, but they weren't there much. In other words, the Petit Nord became more narrowly conceived as the Atlantic coast of the Great Northern Peninsula, between La Cie in the south and Carpoon in the north, rather than the whole northeast coast. I think it started as the whole northeast coast, then it got kind of focused. As early as 1640, the Parliament of Brittany published regulations for the cod fishery in this specific area, but these regulations refer to the area to which it applies only as partie de Terre-Neuve, parts of Terre-Neuve, but it talks about particular places, so you know what they're talking about, but they don't give it the name Petit Nord. The regulations required fishing crews fishing anywhere on the coast between La Cie and Carpoon to send a boat to the Havre de Petit Maître, which was at Croke in the middle of the coast, to register their choice of fishing room. The Basque fishery on the west coast of Newfoundland was administered by similar rules, but it was administered separately. Okay, so it's a different zone. Even after 1821, when masters going to Newfoundland entered a draw for fishing rooms, which they then occupied for the following five seasons, Breton and Norman fishing masters went to Saint Malo to choose from a list of rooms within the historic Petit Nord. Okay, so there's still the same structure. The earliest use of the toponym Petit Nord that I've noted dates to 1669. I've been asking myself, when does it start appearing on maps? And infuriatingly, the earliest maps I can find aren't dated, like this one. It's from about 1700, I think, but that's as much as I can say. One might well ask, several people have asked me this, and I hope there's going to be more questions later. If that's the Petit Nord, what's the Grand Nord? You know, where's the Grand Nord? And one thoughtful questioner asked me once if it could be Brittany itself, because the north coast of Brittany is a kind of a coherent region. I think it was more likely southeastern Labrador. I think that was the Grand Nord, because the Bretons and the Basques had fished there for cod in the 16th century until they abandoned the region in the face of pretty well continual hostilities with the Inuit, the Neo-Eskimo people of the Canadian Arctic. I'm going to digress a bit here briefly to outline, just give you an outline of this forgotten conflict, which I think has something to do with the formation of this concept of the region, Petit Nord. Okay, Amerindian peoples occupied both Newfoundland and southern Labrador in the late pre-contact period. In Newfoundland, these were the ancestors of the historic Beothuk, now culturally extinct. Another Algonquian people, the Innu or Montagnais, occupied southern Labrador. These Amerindian people exploited the resources of the Strait of Belle Isle between Newfoundland and Labrador. In the 16th century, the picture becomes more complicated with the arrival of two new groups, one from the other side of the Atlantic, the Europeans, and a second group from the Arctic, the Labrador Inuit. From the late 16th century through the 17th and well into the 18th, French accounts report organized conflict between fishing crews from Brittany and the Basque Country with native people traveling in skin boats along the coasts of southern Labrador and northern Newfoundland. These were, it seems obvious, the Labrador Inuit. But why were the Bretons and the Basques at war with the Inuit? The Strait of Belle Isle was one of the areas exploited in the early 16th century by Breton, Norman, and Basque fishing crews following Juan Caboto's discovery of new and immensely productive transatlantic fishing grounds. In the 1540s, merchants in the Spanish and French Basque provinces also began to mount whaling voyages to this region, which they called La Grande Baya. For over 40 years, until the 1580s, dozens of ships brought thousands of men who hunted bowhead whales and rendered them into oil at shore stations on the southeast coast of Labrador. A site was at Red Bay was excavated by Jim Tuck. The archaeological visibility of whaling stations, both literally and culturally, has meant that in the popular imagination, Basque whaling was the primary European presence in Atlantic Canada in the 16th century. That's not right. In fact, the early modern migratory cod fishery was not only an earlier industry, but it was also a significantly larger one. Even at Red Bay, the largest and most celebrated Basque whaling station on the Labrador coast, the deposits of cod bone are truly impressive. Contemporary references indicate that Breton, Norman, and Basque crews were regularly setting up seasonal fishing camps in southern Labrador, as well as on Newfoundland's Petit Nord. These 16th century Europeans working in the extractive industries of the Labrador Straits generally maintained friendly relations with Amerindian peoples, including notably the Innu Montagnais. In fact, they employed them sometimes. European relations with the Labrador Inuit developed in a different way. A recent revision of radiocarbon dates by Robert McGee, who used to teach in our department here, Bob McGee's work suggests that the Thule ancestors of the historic Inuit did not reach southern Labrador until the second half of the 16th century. So in other words, the Inuit arrived later than we thought. And of course, at that time, European fishing crews had already established seasonal stations there. The Thule people were seal hunters, who developed a keen appreciation of the advantage of iron tools in their original Alaskan territory. Finding a reliable source of iron was likely their motivation for eastward migration and for late medieval interaction with the Greenland Norse. They were in Labrador to obtain iron, which they already knew they could get from Europeans. As the archaeologist Peter Ramsden puts it, while Europeans came to Labrador in search of new resources, the Inuit came to Labrador in search of new Europeans. That was a very clever line. The obvious way to obtain iron from European seasonal camps was by scavenging, which the Bretons and the Basques vociferously denounced as theft. An efficient alternative was to pick off an isolated boat crew. This tactic could yield knives and other goods, including European shallops, which the Inuit coveted. Both scenarios appear to have played out repeatedly. Given the frequent violence in the Strait of Belle Isle, it's not surprising that early in the 17th century, the Basques abandoned their Labrador fishing and whaling stations to concentrate on whaling in the Gulf of St. Lawrence and on the cod fishery on the south and west coasts of Newfoundland. The Bretons also withdrew from Labrador and concentrated their fishery on the Petit Nord, along the Atlantic coast of the Northern Peninsula. The very context of the Euro-Inuit encounter was not, unfortunately, conducive to friendly relations. They were both newcomers. I think both groups felt, we found this place. What the hell are you doing here? Murderous violence on the Petit Nord was reported as early as 1588. In 1610, Inuit ambushed and killed a number of Breton boat crews at Grandois and Croke. This led Saint-Malo merchants in the following year to arm a vessel to protect the Petit Nord fishery. So for decades, starting in 1610, the Malouins pressed for contributions to their military effort, despite the resistance of the other Breton fishing ports. Finally, in 1647, Louis XIV was like 12 at the time, so it was probably Cardinal Mazarin. Anyway, they got official letters patent, basically, obliging ships from other ports fishing on the Petit Nord to support the Malouin armed escort vessel. And there's evidence that this vessel went out every year. So that's a whole ship devoted to military action rather than the fishery. In 1687, for example, the 220-ton ship, the St. Clair, acted as the patrol, carrying 12 cannons, 72 men, 80 muskets, and 40 pikes. Okay, they weren't cod fishing. The ship and a few men stayed in Croke, but her six auxiliary patache, which are sort of small decked ships or large decked boats, these patache patrolled the coast, and the document says, making war on the savages in order to forestall their incursions against the other vessels. That's my translation, anyway. It's hard to say when Saint-Malo abandoned the practice of sending a ship over. I don't think it's likely to have been before the war that broke out between France and Britain in 1689, and which was not resolved until the Treaty of Utrecht in 1713. After 1713, the situation of both the French and the Inuit changed. The Petit Nord was now the centerpiece of the new diplomatically defined French shore in northern Newfoundland, so it was more used by the French. They were going to have a bigger presence. The French had lost their fisheries elsewhere in Newfoundland, and for migratory transatlantic crews, the coast of southern Labrador was a promising alternative to the overcrowded Cape Breton and Gaspé fisheries. Meanwhile, the Inuit were adapting to trading rather than raiding. The economic strategy of scavenging raids was, of course, inherently unstable in the sense that Inuit methods for obtaining iron tended to drive away the very source that they were exploiting. Trade, once it finally found a foothold, was more predictable and less costly in human terms for all concerned. And in fact, Carol Wolf worked on 17th and 18th century Inuit iron assemblages, and her work suggests that it's in this later period when the Inuit start to trade for manufactured iron goods rather than scavenging stuff and reworking it themselves. So, in summary, Europeans were absent from the coast of Labrador through most of the 17th century, an absence which coincides with a long-running guerrilla war waged by the Inuit against Breton fishers in northern Newfoundland. This coincidence suggests to me that the movement of Inuit into southern Labrador by the end of the 16th century drove European fishers out of Labrador for most of the 17th century and forced Breton fishing merchants to mount an annual defense to protect harbors like Carpoon, Croke, and Cap Rouge. Samelot's defensive effort effectively helped define northeastern Newfoundland as a region of Breton interest, which is a vivid example, I think, of the complex links that exist between Old World and New World ethnicities and Old World and New World regions. So let me return now to the harbors that the Breton fishers exploited and protected along with the Petit Nord, and talk about the scale of the fishing harbor. I'm going to talk about Krause, sometimes called Cap Rouge Harbor, sometimes called Krause Harbor, just north of Conche, which you're more likely to know about, or an hour or two drive south of St. Anthony, if your geography is vague. Significant numbers of European fishers exploited the inshore waters of Newfoundland every summer, likely 15 to 18,000 in the later 17th century. 5,000 to 6,000 of these would be British, and 10,000 to 12,000 already mentioned, French, or from the state of France. Over the 16th and early 17th centuries, fishers from various regions sorted themselves along the transatlantic littoral so that particular Old World ports developed these vernacular links that I've been talking about with particular North American fishing zones. But the areas exploited in places like Newfoundland were only a very small fraction of Atlantic Canada's landmass. Visits to Newfoundland were narrowly focused on relatively few fishing harbors, perhaps 100 around the whole island at this time. Okay, but in each harbor there might be 8 or 10 fishing rooms, but the number of harbors exploited is not that big. The migratory inshore salt cod fishery at Newfoundland was prosecuted from boats, not ships, and the practice of bringing fish back to fishing rooms for processing meant that a small shore station could serve, you know, a big zone. A detailed early 19th century assessment of fishing rooms on the Petit Nord recognizes that the qualities that make a workable fishing room are actually rare, at least in combination. Bryn Tapper's GIS-based analysis confirms that in every period, each fishing crew needed a safe place to moor or careen a ship near reliable fishing grounds with protected water for landing boats, accessible bait species, wood for stages and flakes, open areas for drying, and finally fresh water for the crew. The number of fishing rooms in any one harbor was typically limited, and the fact that the number is finite is clear from the course of expansion in the 18th and 19th centuries, because when expansion comes, it comes largely with intensified use of existing rooms rather than adding more rooms, and rarely adding more harbors. Breton and Norman crews traditionally used about 180 fishing rooms on the Petit Nord, a half dozen or so at most fishing stations. Only a few isolated rooms were located on the outer coast, exposed to the winds and the waves of the open North Atlantic. And I can tell you some of those places are hard to get to. From Carpoon to Lessee, fishing stations were typically located in inner bays within protected harbors. Croke sheltered about 8 rooms in 5 different coves, including the celebrated Havre du Petit Maître, the harbor of the Little Master. Cap Rouge Harbor, an hour or two south by sea, sheltered 8 or 9 rooms in 2 clusters and an outlier. Champéa's kind of an outlier. Conche and Fleur-de-Lis were other major stations. Hundreds of men with dozens of boats used these prime fishing rooms in Croke and Cap Rouge Harbor, while at best only a handful used Millions or Pillier, small and marginal fishing rooms on the unprotected coasts nearby. Through use and repetition over the centuries, the harbor originally known to the French as Cap Rouge became Carouge, and then Carouse, and today it's Krause. Considered as a landmark, Cape Rouge Harbor supports a range of fishing rooms, which we can reconsider at this scale as individual resource landmarks. Close to the mouth of the harbor, our Dos de Cheval site is documented from 1640 on as the fishing room Champéa, or sometimes Champéga, or even Champéga. I still don't know what it means. We found it in, you know, four or five different versions, all, you know, some well-educated French officer hearing some Breton guy say the name, and it's like, well, what did he say, Champéga? You know, so it evolves. Cap Rouge was in use. We know it was in use by 1541 because we have an account of Jacques Cartier's visit, not Jacques himself, but somebody else, en route to Quebec, and it reported that there were five ships' crews fishing there. One of them, I think, would certainly have taken advantage of Champéa's central location within the harbor. Its broad cobble galley, a beach, its view of the open sea, and its proximity to the cod resource. Across the harbor, Northeast Kraus sheltered several prolific fishing rooms, De Grat, De Cap Rouge, Premier and Deuxième, Craquelin and Gogolin. There's some more names that I'd love to know. I'd love to know where they come from. And they're very traditional. They were there for centuries. Some fishing rooms were less productive. There's a nice story I found in those captain's reports I talked about. In 1685, Captain Nicholas Arsan complained that another fishing master had cheated him out of the excellent fishing room he had reserved in Cap Rouge. He'd used the approved procedures, but this other guy pushed him out. So Arsan and his crew made little fish because they were forced to use a much less convenient fishing room in Bicharme, which meant they had to row for an hour before they could get at the fish. This was so far from the resource that it's actually forgotten by the time Captain Francois Thomas Letourneur and his son Claire Désiré mapped the harbor in the 1780s and the 1820s. So that was the worst room, I guess. Breton crews must have regarded the room at the bottom of Kraus Harbor as the best, for they called it La Marotte, alluding to the traditional right of the first arriving master, the admiral, to the first choice of shore space. Paul-Emile Mio's photographic documentation of this room in 1858 clearly depicts its major advantage, that huge cobble beach at Southwest Kraus, used as a ready-made site for drying fish. So these fishing rooms are the most obvious landmarks of the shore-based salt cod fishery, and they're clustered, by and large, in major protected harbors. This clustering follows from economic considerations, for example, productive fishing berths, access to bait, safe anchorage, that kind of thing. But of course, it also facilitated social interaction amongst the men in one particular harbor. So let's move into the scale of the fishing room, okay? We'll go from the scale of the station to the actual fishing room. Champéa was the name Breton fishermen used for the fishing room we excavated at Kraus. The site was structured ritually by a cross on the knoll that overlooks the two main cobble beaches used to dry fish. But the site was also structured by the technical needs of the fishery. From the economic point of view, the center of the site was the fishing stage, a rough timber wharf erected every year on a narrow terrace at the water's edge where crews landed. They landed the fish, they gutted and split it. I'm not talking about that wooden structure up on the hill, which is kind of a landing platform for politicians. Over the centuries, or at least in the imagination of the French Shore Historical Society, that's what it is. Over the centuries, these processing activities created anthropogenic deposits up, that means man-made, up to almost a meter deep. And we exposed these with a cross-cutting trench sloping downwards towards the water. So all that soil you see there is made by fishermen. This trench revealed several significant archaeological features, including an 18th century boat ramp, which seems to have been a kind of satellite to the fishing stage. It was used for repair of boats, we're pretty sure about that, because of the wrought iron artifacts we found associated with it, like clenched nails and a broken gudgeon, which is the thing you use with a pintle to hang a rudder. The ramp was carefully constructed of flat tabular rocks and logs, which you can't really see in that picture, but the rotten wood was there. So we just imagine a log between each of those runs of rock. And the whole thing was sloped and to align exactly with the water's edge at high tide. We can consider features like the stage and the boat ramp as landmarks linked by human practice within the taskscape of Champaya. Taskscape is another useful analytic term, this one borrowed from the British prehistorian Tim Ingold. The taskscape is the spatial expression of what archaeologists traditionally call a chaîne opératoire, the linked steps in production of an artifact. In this case, the artifact was salt cod, and all that remains at the site of production, besides a few cod vertebrae, is the taskscape. The product itself was shipped to southern Europe and consumed centuries ago. The Bretons, by the way, generally shipped their fish to Marseille. Okay, that's where most of it ended up. Some of it went to Bordeaux, but it was mostly to Marseille. Once fish were cleaned and salted on the stage, they were laid out to dry on raised cobble beaches, known to Breton fishers as galets, which literally just means a cobble, and to Norman crews as grave, which means a beach. Champaya has impressive natural galets, but also boasts at least two constructed galets on its upper terrace. Moving the fish was hard work, so crews found that it was worthwhile to improve paths and ramps to give better access to the best drying areas. Two separate ramps lead from the stage area at Champaya, I think you can see it there, to the upper terrace. It took us a while to fully appreciate the details of their construction, and even to realize, we didn't realize immediately that they were natural landforms. It took us a surprisingly long time to spot that. Migratory crews made similar improvements to most fishing rooms. And I got another example at Gogolin, the fishing room in northeast Krause. They not only laid out a raised walkway of tabular rocks along the water's edge, which you can see there, we're sort of standing on it to take the picture, but they also demolished an inconvenient rock promontory to simplify the movement of fish. And you can see the sort of grayish area there where I think they used fire or something to crumble the rock a bit and knock that off. Besides stages, ramps, cobble galley for drying fish and wooden flakes, also used for drying fish, a fishing room like Champaya had to serve the needs of a crew of more than 100 men. Some of the resulting structures are large and well-focused, like the pavement we uncovered, or partly uncovered, in a niche on the hillside overlooking the stage area. We interpret this as a 19th century dormitory, likely covered with canvas sails to form a tent, extrapolating from a wrought iron tent peg that we recovered. The location of this dormitory is a good example of the disaggregation of features which seems to have occurred at Champaya in the 19th century. It's like the site exploded in the 19th century. All of a sudden, it's all over the place. The bread oven is another late feature, which is also isolated from other work or living areas. Jean-Vive Gabou's analysis suggests that these ovens operated somewhat outside the social world of the fishing room, and that they were situated primarily to take advantage of natural shelter from the prevailing southwesterly winds. Oven remains at several other rooms, including Gogolin at Northeast Krause and Camel Island at Griquet, are situated in exactly the same way, against protective rock escarpments. It would seem that bread ovens were part of the economic landscape of the fishing room, the 19th century fishing room, but not an important part of its social space. The bread oven may also reflect shifts in foodways at the time of the French Revolution, sort of like under a regime dedicated to égalité, every citizen deserves fresh baked white bread, which they certainly didn't have in the 16th or 17th century. These features give us a perspective on what we might call the industrialization of the fishery. After 1821, France changed the way fishing rooms were allocated. So it was no longer on an annual first-come, first-served basis, the traditional admiral system. Now, from 1821 on, it was for 5 years at a time, based on a draw. Okay, you put your name in and there was a draw at Saint-Malo. This meant that entrepreneurs in the fishery now had more of an incentive to invest in permanent improvements to fishing stations than they did when they couldn't be sure that they were going to get the same fishing room when they came back the next year. Several major improvements to Champaya, including constructed galley, the dormitory and the bread oven can be dated to the 19th century and I think reflect a willingness to invest in the new five-year control that fishing masters had over particular fishing rooms. It was worth building a little bit more permanently. Excavations around the stage area at Champéat suggest that separation of work and domestic space was weaker in the 17th and 18th centuries. We exposed this hearth, nicely laid out in tabular rocks, dug into the cobble beach, not far from the stage, a few paces from the end of the stage. The stage was always in the same place. Over several seasons, we traced at least two distinguishable burn events between this feature and the shore. Each of these events, strata if you want, was about 6 by 6 meters, and we interpret these as successive mid-18th century cook rooms. Stéphane Noël's work on the faunal remains from these structures finds a relatively high count of hunted rather than imported food. And these hunted foods include caribou and great auk. Well, it was only the officers had spare time to hunt, or even guns to hunt with. They weren't issuing guns to the crew normally. So these eco-facts suggest that what we're looking at here is the remains of what was called the table du capitaine, the captain's table, and not a cook room for ordinary fishermen. Finds of glass tumblers and serving vessels in decorated faience support this socioeconomic analysis. Again, not a normal piece of ceramic for an ordinary fisherman. We uncovered this quasi-domestic feature not far from the stage, as I said. And in fact, it was later actually partly obliterated by the boat ramp, which gives you a pretty good indication of how close it was to the working area. There are other indications on our beach terrace of how work and life or death were intertwined in earlier centuries on our site. Local oral tradition recalls formal 19th century burials in the upper terrace, up behind the site, the terrace that's marked, was later marked with an oak cross, well inland of where the economic activity was. We were surprised to uncover a less formal burial, probably late 17th century, in the beach cobble, again within a few meters of the waterfront stage and cookroom. This was certainly a French fisherman, for he's buried Christian style, facing due east by the compass, with his hands folded in front of him. He may have died from a blow or a shot to the head, and his mates buried him, curiously, with a large iron spike resting on his torso. I still don't have that figured out. This seemed to me a really unusual landmark, until we learned that parallel interments were exhumed in the 1980s at Canada Harbor, the French fishing room of Canary, which is only a few hours by boat down the coast. So this kind of burial in the work area seems to have been normal. Fishing rooms like Canary or Champéat were dense with life and inevitably death. The presence of early burials in the lower terrace, an area used not only for landing fish, but also until the late 18th century for accommodations, this mix-up seems to reflect, to me, a medieval acceptance of death as part of life, rather than a modern or more modern insistence on isolating the dead in another realm, or at least in a separate cemetery several hundred meters away from where you live. Let me zoom in again to the level of a particular feature, and the one I'll consider is the one of the crosses that my student Melissa Burns has identified at Champéat with the assistance of Lavelle student Rebecca Jansen. That's Rebecca in the picture. Not the large cross that we looked at before, the one that was rebuilt by the French Navy in the 1930s up above the site, but this one is what we have is the collapsed rock plinth of an earlier cross, much closer to the water, in the midst of the fishing room. Melissa identified this earlier cross on George Clouet's chart of Cap Rouge Harbor in 1858. She then excavated, found the remains of the plinth, and indeed rotted wood and nails. So this is the earlier ceremonial center of the site. The prominent knoll on which this early cross stood can only be understood as a miniature landscape, for it's laced with paths which approach from every direction. So thoroughly does this spot dominate the immediate surroundings that several years before we identified the plinth, before Melissa said, hey, we should look for this cross there, we had chosen this knoll as our datum point. Okay? This is where we erected our survey equipment. This is where our zero point was. So we had essentially inverted the original use of this natural feature. Breton fishermen erected a cross here because they could see this cultural landmark from almost anywhere in the site. We did it the other way around. We erected our total station there because we could see almost everywhere on the site from that spot. For both historical fishing crews and for our contemporary research team, this little landscape was a landmark within the larger landscape of the fishing room. How do landmarks and landscapes, or landmark landscapes, at various scales fit together? Okay, yeah, here's a tough question. If the landmark-landscape relationship is recursive and can be applied and reapplied at different scales, then what differentiates landmarks or landscapes at different scales? There might be several ways to parse the grammar of landmark-landscape relationships, but on the Piti Nor at least, it seems to me that scale is essentially a socioeconomic question. The individual feature can be seen at as the scale of particular individuals or work teams, okay? So the Kelvair was surely under the auspices of the chaplain. The bread oven is the haunt of the baker and his assistant. The stage is under the control of the cutters and the salters. The scale of the fishing room relates precisely to the crew of a fishing ship. At a somewhat broader scale, that of the fishing harbor, we can identify a landmark like Cap Rouge Harbor in a particular period, say the 17th and 18th centuries, with a particular region, Pays, in the old country, in this case, northern Brittany, particularly Saint-Brieuc and Saint-Malo and their dependent outports. I think it's at this scale, the harbor and the home port in the old country, this is the scale at which analysis of archaeological assemblages permits us to trace most vividly vernacular links between old world and new. And I'm just going to digress briefly on that because it's something I'm proud of. We did a bunch of work on Breton. We identified a number of previously unidentified pottery types in Newfoundland as being Breton. Okay. They don't occur in a lot of places in Newfoundland, only places where the Bretons were. But what's really significant is that not all the Breton stuff is in all the Breton fishing stations. The pot there, that pot was excavated at Ferryland, okay? And it comes from a place called Saint-Jean-le-Porterie in the south of Brittany. Was probably used for provisions coming out of Redon, which was a port that was involved with the fishery in the early years. So there's this link between Ferryland, which has a Breton presence about 1550, and this particular part of the old world. We've also found other wares, for instance, Pabu Gangan, which we don't find at Ferryland, but we do find at a couple of sites in the Northern Peninsula. And the place it comes from is just outside of the port of Saint-Brieuc, which is heavily involved in the fishery at Krause. We've got documentation of it being involved in that fishery. So these archaeological links, I think, help us to trace some of these vernacular cross-Atlantic ties. Anyway, at the circumatlantic scale, the whole Petit Nord was a landmark seen from the central point of view of France as one of several resource peripheries exploitable for fishing. These fishing peripheries, together with the Western European provisioning ports and Southern European markets, constitute our broadest scale, at which admittedly, as I've said before, it's easier to see a circumatlantic landscape than one vast landmark at some world historical scale, so I won't insist on the recursiveness at that scale. Notice that each scale of the recursive landscape project we've undertaken, each scale expresses some aspect of the natural context. For example, certain fishing rooms cluster around a specific natural harbor. Or to take another example, these specific harbors indent this part of the Atlantic coast. Even the circumatlantic economy is structured, if you think about it, around a particular ocean. So on the other hand, each landmark at each scale is also a human construct, culturally distinguished from other landmarks at the same scale. Let's consider our example of crosses as features. Newfoundland's filled with hills. These are natural, but fishing crews transformed some of them into Calvary. Crosses are documented on Breton fishing rooms as early as 1680. The cross sites we have identified invariably dominate the immediate landscape of the surrounding fishing room, sometimes in a spectacular way. For example, Le Sommet de la Croix at Fichaud, that's that one. Or there's a similar hill at Canaries, Le Calvaire at Canaries. At the latter, we noted an anomalous deposit of white marble, which kind of drew our attention. When we persisted with test excavation, we were rewarded with the recovery of a late 18th century rosary. So this gave us confidence in our identification of Calvaries, and in 2009, we identified several probable cross sites simply by their anomalous vegetation. One of the highest and most exposed peaks on Griquet Island supports grasses and meadow weeds. You can see right in front of Melissa there's a nice patch of grass, but there's no other grass up on this hillside. It's a berry barren. Here a vegetation shadow is the trace of human cultural attention that made this particular hill a Calvary among similar hills not distinguished in this way. Melissa argues that these crosses may have functioned as assertions of a Breton presence, particularly after 1713. The Bretons are notoriously fond of crosses, and thousands still stand in Brittany itself, by the roadside and along the coasts. On the Petit Nord, crosses were, in fact, the only non-utilitarian structures created by France's fishermen. They were also almost the only permanent structures in the Petit Nord, because remember, the Treaty of Utrecht banned permanent structures on the French shore, although these crosses were, in fact, erected permanently. Until the 19th century, cabins, cookrooms, and so on were normally demolished at the end of each fishing season. The erection of crosses may have been, in part, a kind of cultural challenge within the context of the ongoing argument with Britain about rights of access to the French shore. Some landmarks, in other words, operate across different scales of landscape. Well, we've treated the whole Petit Nord here as a landmark within a vast Atlantic maritime cultural landscape, including all the maritime zones exploited at one time or another by migratory crews to harvest cod and once linked to the economies of particular European regions. The vernacular cluster Brittany, Marseille, and the Petit Nord that's just one example. France was not alone in sponsoring such links. But for centuries, France was the predominant sponsor of this mode of production. In this sense, and in others, I think the Petit Nord offers us a good example of the maritime cultural landscape of the transatlantic migratory fishery at every scale. Oops. Now, this is the part of my talk, the concluding part of my talk, in which I will, as I would put it, I'm going to gently gnaw the hands that feed me. Before I get to that, let me emphasize, and I mean this sincerely, I consider myself very lucky to have worked with some dynamic local heritage activists and regional heritage associations. Joan Simmons and the French Shore Historical Society in Conche, Steve Knudsen and his son Keir with the Grand Chen Group in Griquet. I'm thankful to have had research support from SSHRC, Memorial, the province, and there's others. And I'm intellectually indebted to a cohort of bright graduate students who helped me piece some of the puzzle together. That's why I'm always saying us or we, because a lot of times it's not really originally my idea. Today, though, I'm worried by what these younger researchers have to face. The federal government has decimated Parks Canada. They've cinched the Canadian Museum of Civilization into a political harness as the repurposed Canadian Museum of History. And they've squeezed SSHRC, the key funding agency for humanities and social science research, with more squeezing to come, I'll bet. The current federal administration presented these draconian cuts as budgetary cost savings, but the radical challenge to some core Canadian cultural institutions makes it obvious, I think, the control of the message of the historical agenda was the more important policy consideration. To take an archaeological example, most land-based archaeologists working for Parks Canada lost their jobs. There aren't even enough left to care for the artifacts that Parks Canada holds, now moldering in suburban industrial parks across the country, let alone to answer a research question. Which archaeologists kept their jobs? The underwater archaeologists looking for the wreck of the Franklin expedition in the Arctic. That was a British ship, of course, but by the Treaty of Westminster, Canada is heir to all that Britain held in. So, let me think. Meanwhile, what happened to the path-breaking Arctic research Pat Sutherland was doing for Canadian Museum of Civilization on early Norse contacts in the Arctic? She's gone. She lost her job. The new Canadian Museum of History does not need that kind of information. It's not in the official script approved by the minister. Of course it isn't. It's new research. It's a lot like fisheries or environmental science. The current federal government simply does not want to know. Or to put things more darkly, they don't want us to know. All this, why am I talking about that tonight? Because it makes university-based research more important than ever. Universities here and elsewhere have tied themselves in knots, making what we do palatable to politicians, and in the end to the corporations that fund the politicians, and to an increasing extent, the corporations that fund the universities. In their rush to meet federal, provincial, and corporate expectations, university administrators, I fear, sometimes need to remember why this university was founded, and indeed what the social function of any significant university is. Take, for example, the strategic research themes Memorial identified a couple of years ago. They're meant to encapsulate existing areas of strength, as well as areas in which Memorial is strategically positioned to expand. This politically charged list includes a diverse range of themes. They're all worthy of careful research. That's not my point. My point is, I think there's some holes in the emperor's new clothes. Reflect on number two. Newfoundlanders have long experience in Arctic exploration, economic development, healthcare, administration, perhaps because we have ocean access. So that makes the Arctic a plausible research focus here at Memorial. I've got to say that. But what about Newfoundland? Or Newfoundland and Labrador? Isn't that a research theme that builds on existing strengths? Wouldn't that help to meet the specifics of our provincial charter? What were they thinking when they drew up this list? That Newfoundland is too narrow a focus? That's so woefully unambitious. My books sell better in the United States and Great Britain than they do in Newfoundland. I think that's because I use Newfoundland as a lens to deal with a broader world. Same goes with Bill Montevecchi's work on the Great Auk, or Trevor Bell's research on sea level change, or the Dictionary of Newfoundland English, or Priscilla Renouf's research on the Dorset Sea Launders of Port of Choix. It's in the specifics that we find evidence for general propositions, and we here in Newfoundland have a competitive advantage regarding research on this island or in Labrador. We're already here. The second rent I see in the research fabric currently draped across the university is the absence of the historical sciences. But isn't heritage there, squeezed in with creative arts and culture? I can't say this often enough. To subsume the historical sciences under heritage is a kind of an insult, not only to the discipline of history, but also to the other historical disciplines of archaeology, classics, historical geography, and in fact to work in the history of ideas carried on by researchers in departments like English, French and Spanish, or German and Russian. History is not heritage. Heritage is a relatively narrow application of historical discipline. Heritage is not history. It's the monetization of history. Let me give a concrete example. In one aspect, the spreadsheet value of research on 17th century Newfoundland lies in contributions to the heritage industry, especially on the Avalon Peninsula, particularly at Cupid's, Fairyland, and Placentia. I have nothing against that. I've worked hard at it. But it's not why we do research on the 17th century. Heritage interpretation is not a contribution to world-renowned scholarship, to use the boast proposed in the Arts Success Plan. We research the past in order to better understand the past, to record, conserve, and analyze past peoples, societies, economies, mentalities, and so on. This is, as the great French historian Marc Bloch put it so well, a relationship between researchers now and people then. It's not a contract to produce a design for an interpretation panel in Signal Hill. The historical sciences explore a fourth dimension of human and indeed natural life with a much greater significance than heritage or even cultural identity. To limit our interest in the past to heritage is like supporting research in mathematics because it might be useful to bankers, or in human rights because it might be useful to lawyers. What researchers in the historical sciences have to fear when faced with such priorities is the absence of clear support, or at least I feel this, an absence of clear, unambiguous support for diachronic research, for research whose prime character is the temporal perspective. What I find even scarier, for my students at least, I'll be gone soon enough, is the extent to which my own Faculty of Arts has bent to these winds, and I hate to say it, but to me, the faculty seems forgetful, at least officially, to the importance of the historical sciences in a flourishing democratic society. Take the research clusters now under discussion by the Faculty of Arts. When archaeologists and historians have asked where we fit in this schema, we've been told that our work is an important strand in theme two, sustainable communities. Well, that's nice to hear. But since when does research in the past necessarily have to do with sustainable communities? You could bend things that way. If you were writing a funding proposal, you could certainly bend things that way. But dressing up the historical sciences in the uniform of sustainability is, to my mind, fitting them for a straitjacket. What it reminds me of was common currency in some circles in my academic youth. The only history is the history of the class struggle. Well, like sustainable communities, that's certainly one thought-provoking way of looking at things. But, and this is a huge but, it is not the whole story. Every society needs people thinking about the whole story, I think. I don't mean that every one of us, man, woman, and child, needs to be or should be absorbed by North Atlantic history and archaeology. Not everyone has to care about the landscapes of the French shore, but we'll be a poorer society if no one marks such things. We all live here in Newfoundland on a subarctic island with a very particular history. As a society, we need to know who we are, and no society can do that without engaging with its own history. In other words, to have a sustainable community, we don't need more history and archaeology about sustainable communities. We need more history and archaeology, period. Okay, these thoughts are, they're not attended as a criticism of individuals, but of the roles that administrators are forced to play by circumstance. More positively, I'll put this more positively now, what I'm asking for is a voice for the academy. Certainly, it's inevitable. University administrators will act in part to implement public policy, politically decided public policy. Of course they will. They have to. But the university community itself is also a constituency. Universities are a crucial part of our national intellectual life. They have a public leadership role beyond the needs of commerce or the needs of government, let alone the needs of the heritage industry. administrators have a duty, I believe, to represent that intellectual consistency as well as to manage it. In the present political climate, this is certainly a challenging job. Thank you.